Yeah. Bigger one.
Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and call the June 3rd, 2019 Solon City Council meeting to order. We'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please.
Mr. McGill?
Here.
Mr. Katara?
Here.
Mrs. Meany?
Here.
Mr. Palunas?
Here.
Mr. Russo?
Here.
Mr. Schmitz?
Here.
Mr. Zellin?
Here.
Okay, changes to the agenda, there are none. Announcements are as published, just one change, the June 12th Safety and Public Properties meeting will now be on June 13th at 6 p.m. here at City Hall. Okay, comments from the audience? Any comments from the audience? Good evening, please state your name and address for the record.
Good evening, I'm Scott Brody, my address is 6363 Huntington Drive in beautiful Solon, Ohio. Well, my wife reminded me on the way here, it's been 13 years since I stood here, back in 2006, this month as a matter of fact.
I think we know why.
But good evening, Mayor and members of the dais. Thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. Recently, for a variety of reasons, my wife and I have had to move out of the city of Solon after 24 years. I was always aware of how lucky we were to live in this wonderful city, but I'm sure you all know the phrase, you don't know what you've got till it's gone. That being said, I'm here tonight to specifically give credit to the City of Solon Service Department. I'm sure that I am forgetting some people specifically. However, I want to give a tremendous amount of credit to Mr. Tom Bandiera, Mr. Bill Dursick, and Alan, who works at the front counter at the service department and is typically the one who answers the phone when residents contact the service department. This dais and the residents of this city need to know how lucky they are to have this group of wonderful people on their staff. No matter what you need, the city probably provides it and is very helpful in performing it. From the city's brush pickup at the appropriate times of the year, to snow plowing, to the almost anything goes pickup on your normal trash day during the first full week of the month, you can be assured that the City of Solon Service Department will take care of it. And at no additional charge. What more can you ask for? And how about providing live or recorded broadcasts of the city's meeting to keep the Solon residents informed of what's going on in the City of Solon, good or bad? So in closing, I just want to thank the Solon Service Department, the dais, for all that you do for the residents of the city, and remind the residents out there how lucky they are to have such a wonderful staff at your service. Thank you again for the opportunity to share my thoughts tonight.
Thank you, Scott.
Thanks, Scott.
Any other comments?
It's nice to hear that.
Good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
Matthew Seifert, 5849 North Oval. I'm reading this for John Solange. It's in first person. I'm up here today not to tear into Jeremy or talk about the trail. I'm here to talk about an incident that happened to me as I was leaving the last council meeting. I'm hoping that each person up here will condemn what happened and speak to the fact that something like this should never happen again. As I was leaving last meeting, I was outside heading to my car when two people followed me outside to have a little discussion with me. Needless to say, this was not a friendly conversation on their part. They might consider that I could exit the situation was to agree to their terms and shake the hand of one of them. The terms were to not tell lies about Jeremy and to not bring Jeremy's father into any more of my talks. I'm sorry if you think that I am telling lies about Jeremy. The way to combat that is to come up here and tell your truth about Jeremy. Although they may seem like lies to you, they may even seem personal, they are not. They are what I, along with many people, see as the truth about Jeremy as a council person. I can also assure you, none of the comments about Jeremy as a person. I don't know Jeremy the person, and I'm sure he is probably pretty happy about that. The comment I made about Jeremy's father was a comment he said in front of this very council, and I feel it was a very eloquent and passionate statement. He pleaded to Jeremy that if he made a promise to a group of people, that he should keep that promise. I see nothing wrong with bringing that up. I was, however, told that if I kept bringing up lies about Jeremy, and if I kept mentioning his father, that this same sort of ambush type of situation would occur again. I think council and the mayor should renounce this and promote the freedom of speech up here at this public forum. For most of us, this is an effective way to create change. If I thought people were doing a good job, I would be just as passionate up here praising you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other comments? Good evening.
This one worked too.
Good evening. I'm Brian Fletcher, 37275 Fox Run Drive. And I would share the fine job that's done here in Solon. It's a true privilege to live here. I don't know how long each of you has sat here on the board. I thank you for your service. And we have a power outage problem, and it's double fold now, I think. But it's been going on for years. I have called in myself and been told that it would be looked into, and it just keeps recurring. You don't know how long you're going to be out for dinner because you don't know what's going to happen when you get back. It affects about 10 homes. So I would think an electrical problem could be resolved within the matter of years. It makes me question. Also, I'm a CPAP user. I have a neighbor who's a CPAP user. That'll wake you up constantly in the middle of the night because we've had fluttering power problems. So with that in mind, I hope something can move forward. I thank you all.
Thank you. Any further comments from the audience? Any further comments? Okay, moving on to the Planning Commission consent agenda, item number one.
An application was received from Aomade and Christy Adelecki for property located at 33260 East Nimrod Street for a 32 square foot accessory structure area variance, which was approved.
Item number two.
An application was received from Carol Helberg for property located at 6618 Chagrin River Road for a number of accessory structures variance to permit a total of 5, which was approved. 6,800 square foot stable area variance, which was approved. 35 foot stable side yard setback variance, which was approved, contingent upon application for a lot consolidation if the property is ever sold. That was approved.
Thank you. Item number three.
An application was received from Brandon and Rena Polian for property located at 7174 Thistle Drive for a 12 foot rear yard setback variance, which was approved.
Thank you. Item number four.
An application was received from Bobby Lekic for property located at 32250 Burlwood Drive for a 48 square foot accessory structure area variance, which was approved, and a 5 foot side yard setback variance, which was also approved.
Thank you. Item number five.
Application was received from St. Rita's for property located at 33200 Baldwin Road for a 69-foot side yard setback variance, which was approved, 49.5-foot rear yard setback, which was approved, and also site plan. Planning Commission recommended approval contingent upon the installation of screening on the south property line.
Thank you. Item number six.
An application was received from Jing Li for property located at 7099 Navajo Trail for a 9-foot rear yard setback variance for a garden, which was approved.
Mr. Palunas.
Move to approve the Planning Commission consent agenda.
Okay, motion by Mr. Palunas, seconded by Mr. Schimmitz. Roll call, please.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mr. Katora?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay, moving on to pending, item number seven.
Item number seven is a proposed rezoning of permanent parcel number 952-26018 from the C3 Commercial Zoning District to the I2 Industrial Manufacturing Zoning District, located near Sedlak Interior in Errico. This item was referred to the Planning Commission, and the Planning Commission has continued ongoing public hearings, and there's no other material.
Okay, we have no new material. Okay, item number eight.
Item number eight is a proposed rezoning of permanent parcel numbers, originally permanent parcel numbers 954-02035, 954-02088, and 954-02089. This was the former Liberty Ford site, from the C4 Motorist Service Commercial District to a proposed mixed-use planning district. On May 28th, there was a revision provided, a revision to the proposed rezoning, which would amend the City of Solon Zoning Code and create a new MPDA mixed-use planning district classification, and it would rezone certain property located in the C3 and C4 commercial zoning classifications into the new mixed-use planning district. This was referred to the Planning Commission, and a public hearing is scheduled for June 25th.
At this point, I will move for a public hearing to be scheduled for June the 17th and July the 1st.
Okay, a motion by Mr. Palunas, seconded by Mr. Zellwin. Roll call.
Mr. Katora? Excuse me. Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zellwin?
Yes.
Okay, item number nine.
Okay, item number nine is an appeal from Attorney Kenneth Fisher, representing Christopher and Teresa Vasek and Greg Greenspan, in regard to the April 9th, 2019 Planning Commission decision denying a front yard setback variance. This item was tabled on May 6th, and appeal was heard on May 20th, and the appeal is continued.
Okay, we did have a lot of testimony at our previous meeting. I know there were two residents, one that was out of town and one that chose to wait till this evening to speak. I'll turn this over now to our assistant law director, Mr. Chalarsky. But just so you know, my plan is to let the residents talk. If you spoke at the last meeting, only really if you have something new to add. Otherwise, I believe then we'll have Mr. Greenspan's attorney come up, and I think he had a little bit more evidence he wanted to present.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. Again, as I said at the previous meeting, as a quasi-judicial proceeding, I would ask that all witnesses be sworn and all evidence admitted or proffered be marked and made part of the record of this proceedings. So at this time, anybody, including Mr. Franklin and Mr. Bush, anybody with new information or that didn't get the opportunity to speak at the last meeting and you intend to speak this evening, if you could stand and raise your right hand and be sworn. Okay. Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you give and the evidence we present will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Okay. And as you approach, if you could acknowledge that you've been sworn prior to your offering your testimony. Thank you.
Okay. So Mr. Snyderman, I don't know if you want to go for, okay.
Okay.
Okay, good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
John Patrum, 37182 O'Neill Drive, and I have been sworn.
Okay.
I spoke last time. See the document here. I'm just going to hit on the additional new items that I submitted to you folks on May 18th. Okay. Item number three, the proposed driveway along with a side entry garage entry pad would create the following negative impacts. Require the elimination of a minimum of 35 mature trees that would be a combination of property dividing trees as well as trees that will be eliminated due to the obvious reason to make space for the driveway as well as the proposed housing. Item B on number three is create a water runoff pitch of a minimum of 6 degrees into our own individual backyard. This creates a high potential of backyard flooding due to the need for an elevated driveway. And I took measurements from my own property, and I've got the calcs to back that up, Mr. P.E., to substantiate that. That elevation difference is over 2 feet. And that is one of my big fears, as when we have a lot of rain, the back of our yard gets inundated. And even with the storm runoff, it still creates havoc in the very far back. So I did want to bring that up to you all. And then the final item, number four, the requested setback of 225 linear feet is over 3 times the setback distance of the following Liberty Road addresses, 5960, 5950, and 5940. And over the years, the Solon Planning Commissioners have crafted zoning ordinances with the forethought of maintaining symmetrical neighborhood sight lines. The appeal for variance request creates a total lack of site uniformity and devalues the visual aesthetic alignment of the Liberty Road houses. And in conclusion, this is the data that I have drawn upon, and I highly ask that you folks take the time to come to the site and see for yourself the issues that creates our reasoning to appeal this. I thank you for your time.
Mr. Patram, did you have any other documents to submit, or you've already submitted?
I already submitted, and I hope you all took the time to review them from my past.
Okay, I believe your correspondence of May 18th is part of the record.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Specifically for the record, it's Exhibit BB.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening. My name is Mark Snyderman. My wife and I own a home located at 37172 O'Neill Drive in Solon, and I have been sworn. Before I begin my remarks, I'd like to thank the council for scheduling its vote on this matter tonight so that I might speak with you in person. I was out of the country at the time of your last meeting and unable to be present. I watched the video of the last meeting, and I know that you have already devoted a substantial amount of time to this matter. So again, I thank you for your patience and for your willingness to delay the vote until tonight. Am I in the right spot here? Yes? Okay. Our property adjoins lot number 10 on Liberty Road, the parcel of land for which the setback variance is being sought. If the setback variance is granted, the Greenspans plan to build a home that I believe is out of character with the neighborhood, and as a result, would result in a lengthy driveway being built along the backyards of several homes on O'Neill Drive, and also would result in a home sitting close to my backyard as well. I think such an outcome would be contrary to the city's intentions when it developed and enacted its zoning code, and I respectfully ask you to uphold the code. The zoning codes in Solon are designed to provide for safety, uniformity of neighborhoods, and predictability for property owners. Solon is known for having a strong code and for adhering to it. When we built our home, our Solon home on O'Neill Drive in 1988, we knew there was a vacant lot on Liberty Road on which a home might someday be built. However, we also knew that the front yard setback for that property was 70 feet and trusted that any eventual home would be held to that standard in Solon's code. I have no problem whatsoever with a house built at that setback. However, the Greenspans are requesting a setback of 225 feet, an extraordinary deviation from the code. Their position is that a variance is appropriate due to the presence of a stream on the property, a stream whose presence makes building a home on the property otherwise impossible. Does their request meet the requirements of a practical difficulty, as Attorney Ken Fisher discussed at your last meeting? Well, I'm not a lawyer, but I think not, and I'll give you three reasons. First and foremost, based on the discussions held at the April 9th Planning Commission meeting, it seems highly likely that a house meeting the 1,800 square foot minimum requirement can be built on the property at the 70 foot setback. I contacted Planning Director Rob Franklin about this, to discuss this. He said the Greenspans did not submit a plan for a house at the 70 foot setback, so no evaluations were done. The only plan submitted was for a much larger setback. At the Planning Commission meeting on April 9th, Mr. Greenspan stated he could build a home at the 70 foot setback, but that's not the home that he wanted to build. If a house can be built at the regular setback, there's no practical difficulty in using the property. I'm unaware of any analysis that says a house can't be built at that setback. If so, rebutting Mr. Fisher's point, a reasonable return can be earned on the property without a variance. Point number two, Mr. Fisher said that the requested 225-foot setback is not substantial, but it would result in a setback roughly three times the norm and out of step with all the others on the street, as can be seen here. These are the other houses on Liberty. And the proposed house is way back here. These are the homes on O'Neill. Mr. Fisher says it's not substantial because it's the minimum required to build on the lot. But I think that claim is in doubt for reasons I've already stated. Third, Mr. Fisher said that the requested variance would not change the character of the neighborhood, another aspect of the practical difficulty test. He would have you compare the proposed house to those of mine and a few others who are adjacent to the lot on Liberty. But the relevant comparison, I think, is to the neighbors on Liberty Road. An 1,800 to 2,000 square foot home is right on the average house size, the average of the house sizes of the five adjacent homes running along Liberty Road between Timber Lane and O'Neill. And that's the relevant comparison for conformity. Each of these five houses sits at the regular setback. Mr. Fisher referenced two houses further away on Timber Lane that are set back more than others on Timber Lane. He says this was due to avoid the stream, but I don't think this is any more than conjecture on this part. On his part, I didn't see any evidence as to why those houses were set back. What's more, and perhaps more important, based on the design submitted to the Solon Planning Commission, the Greenspans appear to be planning to put their roughly 3,000 square foot house on a very large footprint, 50 by 60 feet, which I take to mean a one-story home, whereas the adjacent homes have two stories and much smaller footprints. In other words, the Greenspans want an extraordinary variance to build a house that takes up much more ground space than any of the other homes in the neighborhood and would require a very lengthy driveway to reach it. A house such as this is certainly out of character with adjacent homes. However, a house with a 50 by 60 footprint will not fit at the 70 foot setback. The Greenspans are well aware of the stream on the property, which is why they contracted for an option to buy the property subject to obtaining the variance. They are not obligated to purchase the property if you uphold the zoning code. The city did not place the stream there, and it's not obligated to grant a variance because of it. I don't believe there's any taking of the property in this matter. The variance is not being requested out of necessity, but to satisfy the petitioner's desire to build a large footprint house where they want to build it on the lot. Finally,
I feel obligated to address a point that arose concerning neighbors, such as me, who have benefited from the land being vacant for many years and are now objecting to the development of the property. As I stated at the outset, the lot was vacant when I built my home over 30 years ago. I always assumed that a home might eventually be built at the 70-foot setback. Over this long period of time, for sale signs went up and came down on this property many different times. 6 years ago, well before the Greenspans obtained an option on this property, I contacted Mr. Vasek about purchasing the land along with several of my neighbors so that we could split it and adjoin it to our parcels. He was not interested in discussing this with me at the time because it seemed as though we were fairly far apart on the price. I asked him to please contact me at any time in the future if he did reduce his asking price, as my neighbors and I remained interested. I wish that he had done that, but unfortunately I only discovered that he did considerably reduce the asking price when I became aware of the Greenspan's variance request. If Mr. Greenspan decides not to purchase the land, I remain interested in acquiring it along with the neighbor. In closing, I'd ask you to focus on the requirements for granting a variance. The city should not grant this request because no one has shown that a house cannot be built at the 70-foot setback. Just because someone wants to build a larger home elsewhere on the property does not justify a substantial variance that would result in a house out of character with the neighborhood. This would be a bad precedent for the city. I don't see a valid reason for the city to contravene its setback rules by granting the variance, and neither did your planning commission. As you know, it voted 4-1 to turn down the requested variance. We're very grateful that the planning commission was so strong in its denial of the variance, and we're confident that it made the right call. We ask that you support their judgment and uphold Solon's code. Respectfully ask that you deny this appeal. Thank you again very much for your consideration this evening.
Mr. Steinberg, do you have any documents beyond your letter of March 18th, which is Exhibit I?
No, just thank you. That
can
in
we,
my
can we steal that exhibit that you this? The aerial? Yes.
Sure.
Like to mark that as FF for the record?
Sure.
So to go along with your testimony?
Sure.
Thank you.
Yes.
Good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
My name is Ruben Gutartz, 5197 Barrington Court, Solon, Ohio.
Have you been sworn?
I have been sworn. Thank you. A little bit about myself. My wife Inga and I have lived in Solon, Ohio for 22 years of our lives. I grew up in Solon. I played football for Solon. I graduated with honors from Solon High School. Councilman Katora and Palunas, you may or may not remember me, but I was just a grade below the two of you in high school. When I finished my endodontic residency at The Ohio State University, the first thing my wife and I did was to move back to Solon and raise our kids here. Our kids are now both honors graduates from Solon High School and are in the scholars program at The Ohio State University. My wife and I are here to talk about actual facts and numbers and to vouch for Mr. and Mrs. Greenspan, whom we have been close friends with for the past 23 years. There are some people in this room that have demonized the Greenspans and have made them out to be villains just because they want to build a house on a large piece of residential property that could not be further from the truth. In fact, they are true model citizens. Mr. Greenspan has had his company in Solon for the past 17 years. He and his company are responsible for machine components used by NASA, by the U.S. Armed Forces that protect our nation, and by the U.S. Navy submarines. Mrs. Greenspan has been the occupational therapy director at the Belfair Monarch School for Children with Autism. She has cared for and improved the lives of so many children with autism. Kids that cannot complete daily activities such as bathing, dressing, grooming, brushing their teeth, and handwriting like you and me So many families have been affected positively by her devotion, because raising a child with autism is an enormous, overwhelming task. The Greenspans are asking for a 220-foot setback because of a water stream going through their front yard. So let's be rational here and make some sense without preconceived notions. In fact, Councilman Katoran Palunas, when we went to Solon High School, we were governed by an extremely rational man. He was one of the nicest, caring, and most rational men that I have ever come across. Of course, I'm talking about Principal Katori, your father. He had a strict open door policy for all his students, and he spoiled us rotten because he loved us. Although he may have had some preconceived notions about certain students, he always put them aside to listen to the evidence and reason. So here are some numbers. All the neighbors that are involved and that are against the Greenspans have approximately 3,500 square foot home sitting on approximately 0.6 acre of land. The Greenspans would also like to build a home of approximately 3,500 square feet, but their land is 1.6 acres. Their plot of land is almost three times the size of their neighbors, so they actually have the room to set their house back from the stream so as not to disrupt the natural body of water. And some have suggested that the Greenspans fit their home that is much smaller, or make a home that's much smaller than all their neighbors' homes at the 70-foot setback, approximately a home half the size of the O'Neill neighbors' homes on a land that is almost three times the size of their land. How is this fair? Some other numbers. Each of the O'Neill neighbors' homes and the Liberty homes are approximately 30 feet away from one another. 30 feet away. Yet the Greenspans' proposed setback, the Greenspans' home will be, listen to these numbers, approximately 101 feet from the closest Liberty neighbor, 178 feet from the one of the O'Neill neighbors, approximately 140 feet from the second O'Neill neighbor, 148 feet, 167 feet, 242 feet from the other O'Neill neighbors. All that versus 30 feet. And the neighbors are accusing them of building in their yard. Really? In fact, if the Greenspans build at the actual 70-foot coated setback, they will be closer to three of the six neighboring homes. So where's the logic in complaining here? More numbers. Zero of the six neighbors' homes have a body of water running through their front yard. The Greenspan's property does. Isn't this why we have variances? So they can set back a similar size home as their O'Neill neighbors and not disturb that body of water? Don't all of you feel that we are wasting all this time on this case when there is already a house down the very same road at 6406 Liberty with a 215-foot setback because there is a stream running through the front yard exactly like the one on the Greenspan's property? In conclusion, I ask that the council think rationally with logic, look at the evidence and the statistics and get rid of any preconceived notions and approve the variance for Mr. and Mrs. Greenspan. Thank you for your time.
Sir, could you, the clerk didn't quite hear, your name again?
Reuben Gutartz, 5197 Barrington Court.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Good evening. Please state your name and address for the record.
Inga Gutartz, 5197 Barrington Court. I've been sworn in. My name's Inga, as I've said. I've been a resident of the city of Solon for a total of 22 years. I'm here tonight to support my friends Anya and Greg Greenspan in building of their home on the property that they would like to purchase. I also support the development and change in our city. I disagree and do not support the neighbors near this property who are all mainly the original homeowners of their homes and do not advocate for lawful change and development. Over the past two council meetings, these neighbors have shown an unfounded discrimination towards my friends, which this city council has supported. The fact that these people have discussed their cat using the property and their kids using it as well is ridiculous and selfish. In essence, that is illegal trespassing on the land that's not theirs and does not belong to them. I believe this is wrong. And I urge you to allow for the variance that the Greenspans are requesting. Thank you for your time.
Good evening.
Good evening. Alex Mikhailov, 6368 Woodbury Drive. I was sworn in. Well, I'm here with my family to support our friends Greenspans. And, well, I've been here for the second, you know, council meeting. And it's really, I can't beat Ruben's numbers. They speak for themselves, but I'm more kind of a common sense guy. And, by now, listening to the opposite side, I kind of get to understanding why the neighbors supporting the notion of that Greenspans can't build and fiercely opposing the variance. It's a very strong case of buy the cow when the milk is free. For many years, they've been using this property like their own, without paying a penny for it. And I guess if it's okay with the previous, with the owners, it's fine. They had their chance to purchase the property. They didn't, they passed. So now that the cow's almost gone and the milk is gonna dry out, they're opposing it. So they're bringing their feelings to this chamber and let's see in the plain sight what the feelings are. One neighbor comes with the feeling that they already flooded of 20 years yard is gonna be more flooded. The other gentleman with his father feel like they can dictate Greenspans what size of the house they wanna build. I think we live in the free enough country when we can make this decision on our own, well, with the city approval. Well, and I mean no disrespect to another gentleman that is industrial engineer, but he feels that he has enough knowledge in the topography and civil engineering to bring a strong conclusions of the effect. Now let's look at another side. Let's look at the facts. And I think Ruben presented very strong numbers, but I think we should have stopped on the last evening when our city engineering department put on the table a conclusion that was based on the research, on the studies. I know these guys do their homework. And they said that the property, the house built on the requested property will not affect anything. Not extra flooding, not the environment, nothing, zits. So without all this being said, the effects from the city engineering department, the numbers that our friends presented, the only thing that I can respectfully ask is, when you're gonna vote, please use the facts, not the feelings. Thank you.
Further comments?
Eric Golubitsky, I've been sworn in.
Please state your name and address for the record.
Eric Golubitsky, 6712 Winston Lane, Solon.
Thank you.
You know, when it rains, my backyard also is so wet. Just wanted to throw that out there first. This land is not owned by any of these neighbors. They have no rights and were simply wrong by any and all of their claims. These neighbors are not only here to prevent someone else from owning and developing this land for their own selfish and personal gains. They've taken advantage of this land for years, never offering to buy it, improve it, etc., just to sit there for their illegal benefit. Anyone else that buys this land will have to have this same variance done to make the lot buildable, and it's obviously a very challenging undertaking. We have this great family that is willing and motivated to improve this land and improve our community. Why would anyone get in the way of that? It would be a really, really sad day if this long-time Solon family that has two kids that graduated from Solon schools, work in Solon for so many years, and decide and leave to go to Aurora, Bainbridge, etc. What a huge loss to this community. And sending the wrong message that Solon is no longer where you build what you want to build, your dream home, because you'll be surrounded by self-serving, horrible neighbors. Every one of the neighbors' concerns were debunked and proven not true by engineers, etc., and by common sense and by law. They don't want to see a house in their backyard. They live in a development surrounded by other developments. There are thousands of homes in Solon built where builders, developers, homeowners heard from neighbors that they didn't want. Can you imagine Solon today if these variances weren't granted? Especially variances where the only logical choice for the community development to happen is to approve the variance. Please support the family that is looking to build a home they will retire into and fulfill their American dreams in Solon. And please do not reward, or worse, turn Solon's reputation in the city where self-serving neighbors get rewarded. Thank you.
Any further comments? Any further comments? Okay. the applicant and his attorney. Good evening. Please state your name
good
and address
evening,
for the record.
Mr. Mayor, Madam Vice Mayor, esteemed members of council. My name is Dennis Nevar. I'm with Kenneth Fisher, LPA, here on behalf of the appellants. As an initial matter here, I would request that the June 3rd, 2019 correspondence that was previously provided to council at the caucus meeting be included in the record in this matter.
I think that's your exhibit two. I think there was an exhibit at the, is that one? Or?
The June?
This is I think June. You submitted an exhibit at the last meeting, Ken?
Correct. That was dated May 20th
yes.
with
so
documentation as
this
well.
This would be appellant's exhibit two?
Yeah.
Okay.
And just a brief summary, that is a spreadsheet detailing about nine separate properties in the area, similar situated, who have received front setback area variances from the Planning Commission, different distances, of course, depending on what was minimally required to develop the property. I'm going to keep this brief here. As you know, Mr. Fisher previously addressed you on May 20th and addressed the specific Duncan factors for a practical difficulty standard for the granting of an area variance. Our May 20th correspondence previously in the record, I believe, is Appellant's Exhibit 1, specifically addresses each of those Duncan factors. Also included in that May 20th correspondence was a variance analysis prepared by Julie Lindner, a certified planner well-respected in the area in her field. And there was also included in there a March 15th fire department summary indicating that the fire department had no issues with the requested area variance. Included in the record as well is a March 20th memorandum from city engineer Mr. Bush indicating in pertinent part that the proposed development of the subject property must comply with all stream and wetland requirements. And certainly the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers has opined on this issue as well, confirming that development outside of the existing stream area is highly preferred for numerous reasons as detailed therein. And separately, of course, the city has introduced Exhibit BB, where there was a couple more similarly situated properties identified for setback variances, including email correspondence from Mr. Bush advising that the subject property proposed to be purchased by Mr. Greenspan does not drain towards the neighboring properties on O'Neill Drive, and further confirming that those O'Neill Drive properties did in fact have storm sewers located in their backyards. Accordingly, we have one area variance that's being requested here, which is the minimum necessary to allow for the development of the property in an economically beneficial manner. And of course, if this council deems it that the variance should be granted, the story doesn't end here. There's going to be engineering plans submitted to the city. There's going to be site plans submitted to the city. The city still retains jurisdiction over the approval of any development of the subject property. Accordingly, we believe all the Duncan factors have been met by an abundance of the evidence, and the appellants request that the decision of the Planning and Zoning Commission be overruled and grant the requested 152-foot foot front setback area variance to allow for the development of the subject property at a distance of 225 feet from the Liberty Road right-of-way. Of course, Mr. Greenspan is here if there are any specific questions that that he can address or myself.
Okay, I think we'll bring it back to the dais. Mr. Greenspan, did you want to say anything at this point in time?
Okay.
We'll bring it back, and I don't know if any members of council. Yes. Mr. Palunas?
This was, just so we can refresh everyone's recollection, this was denied at the Planning Commission by a 4-1 motion. The mayor, myself, Mr. Bentley, and Mr. Mazur voted against this variance. And part of the reason why I voted against this variance, I didn't feel it met the, heard a lot of conversation tonight about the factors for the variance. I did not feel that it met all the factors stated in Duncan versus Middlefield, especially when the applicant himself agreed that there could be a home built on this property, just not the home that he wanted to have built on the property. You could build a smaller home on the property, and you could build the home within the existing setbacks. So I do not feel that this should be overturned.
Can I just say one thing before we proceed? I'd like Mr. Stolarski to give us the law and then let every councilman have it. There's been some discussion about what the law is. I've had discussions with Mr. Fisher and Mr. Nevar. But before we go further on this thing, you've heard what the law is. I want to get it from our law director to tell you what the law is so that you can confirm what it is. And then you can apply the facts that you deem right. He will also be giving an instruction on the credibility of the witnesses, which I've also discussed with Mr. Nevar, so that you know what rights you have and what you're allowed to believe in, how you judge it, et cetera. So I'd like you to have that before you make any further comments. Thank you, Mr. Stolarski.
Thank you, Mr. Lobey. In making this determination, as the Planning Commission did, whether the requested variance is consistent with the public health, safety, welfare, and the Board of Zoning Appeals, as this council is required by Chapter 1293, B, to apply the practical difficulties tests as specified by Duncan versus Middlefield. Chapter 1293 is Exhibit B of your packet, and Duncan versus Middlefield is Exhibit C of your packet. Through that case, the factors to be considered and weighed in determining the whether property owner seeking an area variance has encountered practical difficulties in the use of his or her property include, but are not limited to, whether the property in question will yield a reasonable return or whether there can be any beneficial use to the property without the variance, whether the variance is substantial, whether the essential character of the neighborhood would be substantially altered, or whether adjoining properties would suffer a substantial detriment as a result of the variance, whether the variance would adversely affect the delivery of governmental services, such as water, sewer, or garbage, whether the property owner purchased the property with the knowledge of the zoning restriction, whether property owner's predicament was feasibly can be obviated through some method other than a variance, and finally, whether the spirit and intent behind the zoning requirement would be observed and substantial justice would be done by granting the variance. Members of council, I would remind you that you are the judges of the facts, the credibility of the witnesses, and the weight of the evidence. You are not required to believe the testimony of any witness simply because the witness was under oath. You may believe or disbelieve any or part of the testimony of any witness. It is your duty to decide the testimony to believe what testimony not to believe. The testimony of one witness, if believed by you, is sufficient to prove any disputed fact. Thank you.
Mr. Fisher, Mr. Nevar, do you have anything else to add on the instructions of law, or do you object to them, or do you want to consent to them?
Okay. I do want to make one brief comment, though, and it's going to be directed towards Councilman Paloonis, and respect his comment, but I do want to be able to say, though, that on the record at the last meeting, Mr. Greenspan did testify under oath that the comment he made that a smaller house could be built was done, again, out of frustration. Okay, not because a smaller house can be built, but out of frustration. And that's his testimony under oath, and I do want to make that statement for the record.
Mr. Fisher, hold on. Let's keep this as a hearing. The evidence has been submitted. We are here now at that portion where the evidence is concluded. Mr. Fisher, I did watch and stream it. That was stated, so it's already part of the record. And we're on that portion of the hearing now where the instructions of law is being given, like, to these fact finders, and they will determine what's in the record, what's not in the record, what evidence they want to believe, not to believe, and the weight and the credibility given to them. But that was in the record. But from this point forward, we're not taking any more evidence, or we don't want to debate further. The fact finders will make it. I just wanted to make sure that, do you have an objection as to the instruction of law that was given? And by you shaking your head, I assume you agree with it. And I talked with Mr. Nevar, and I told him what this is going to be. So now that everybody has their instructions of law.
One more point. Vice Mayor Meany and members of council, I would ask that all documents be admitted as part of the record. The documents submitted on behalf of the city and those submitted on behalf of the applicant as part of the record of the proceedings, and also the video record of the meeting, the previous meeting, and tonight's meeting be incorporated into the record as the best evidence of these proceedings. It will require the affirmative vote of four members of council to grant the appeal and overturn the decision of the Planning Commission. And I would remind everyone that the decision of this body, whatever it is appealable to the Court of Common Pleas by any interested party pursuant to Chapter 2506 of the Ohio Revised Code.
Mr. Stolarski, would you advise him how I'm going to want the motion phrased right now so we know?
Yeah, for clarity, we would ask that the motion be made in the affirmative. So, however you're considering voting, for instance, the motion would be motion to grant the appeal. So yes means yes, you in favor of the variance. So the motion would be to grant the appeal filed by the Greenspans. Thank you.
Does everybody understand that?
Yes.
If you're in favor of granting the appeal and overturning the decision of the Planning Commission, you will vote yes. If it is your intention to not grant the variance and you want to uphold the Planning Commission's, you vote no. As we proceed forward here, I think we should allow every one of the council people to not get in a debate with each other. You've now heard all the evidence. You've been given the law, the Duncan versus Middlefield. I think we should go down. You are the triers of the fact. I want you to now apply what your vote is. So we're going to make a formal motion, and then we're going to allow everybody to speak. Please analyze the law and why, how and why you vote. I don't want to influence you, but whatever your vote is, please apply some facts from the evidence that you heard. Please do not get too long, but we want everybody to justify their vote. Any questions from the council before we take the motion?
I do have a question, Mr. Logan.
Yes.
Is this for a 235-foot setback
total,
or is it 225 total? Because both those numbers have been mentioned this evening.
Mr. Franklin, can you give some clarification on that?
The
number that was voted on by the Planning Commission was a 220-foot setback, 153-foot variance.
Okay, so the memo from March 21st is not accurate. So it's a, what exactly, it's 157, you said?
There's been various plans were submitted throughout the process. The variance that the Planning Commission voted upon was for the 220-foot setback.
The setback, the permittable setback is 70 to 70 plus feet.
That is
an additional 150, which gets you to the 220. Somewhere.
Mr. Law Director, the correct setback is 67 feet. Normally, that's it's 70 to 73 feet, according to the zoning code. But in this case, it was a matter of averaging the houses on either side. So the actual required setback was 67 feet.
Any other questions by any council person before we go to the motion to vote? Yes, Mr. Zell.
Can I ask Mr. Bush a question?
Yes, you may.
So, Mr. Bush, can you talk about the potential water challenges that have been brought up in the stormwater plan in that area, and if the setback that is being requested would have an impact on potential drainage and where that water currently drains to?
I have been sworn. The larger the setback, and I think it was mentioned tonight, the longer the driveway, there will be some more runoff from the longer driveway. But that'll, with our review, like we would review any topo, we'll assure that it gets pitched towards the stream and not towards the O'Neill homes. And we'll review it like we would any others, regardless of the setback.
What about the stormwater in the backyard? Do you have, I think you shared a visual. That's what I was getting at. Thanks, John. Like a Marine, he always comes prepared.
This is the, in blue, the perimeter is the lot in question. These are the homes on O'Neill Landing here. Generally, the water drains from the west towards the east. I have a few arrows here that kind of depict what I feel is, the, in my opinion, how the water drains towards the stream. Here is the stream draining towards Liberty Road. There is, and this is a plan from our GIS mapping that the city uses. There is a representative here in green, a rear yard drainage system along the backyards of the homes on O'Neill Landing that abut that property. And just for council's understanding, this is actually a copy of the subdivision plan. Again, I'm kind of going to put it in the same perspective here. So you can see that green line. This actually is the subdivision plan, and this shows the actual storm sewer that was installed with the subdivision. And I went back and looked at some of the individual topos from when these homes were built, and these drains are all represented on those individual topo plans as well.
So
they are,
as
they,
a non-engineer,
they,
so just so
they
I can
are
understand.
They are there to collect runoff.
So I'm going to speak as a layman person. So please, the water,
I'm trying as
is
well.
Pitched. those are designed so the water's supposed to go from their backyard towards
generally,
the stormwater plan.
The water from the O'Neill properties would drain this way, and if there was any water coming here, it should help pick that up and take it out to Liberty Road.
And then you're saying that the water on the property drains towards the stream.
Generally, yes. The property in question in blue, generally the water would drain this way towards the stream.
Okay. And then this, I think this was talked about last meeting, so just want to clarify. So if there's gutters on the house, those would be tied into a stormwater system as well and not drain onto the property?
Depending on where they're located on the property, they may discharge directly towards the stream. Or possibly a swale that we would probably most likely require along this side of the property, but we'd get into more of the specifics of that as we would review the individual topo.
And if the permit, or if the variance were to be granted, this would still have to go through engineering review and approval.
Absolutely.
Prior to any house being built.
Absolutely.
Up to city standards. All right, thank you.
Any other questions by any other councilman prior to the vote?
Thank you.
your knowledge, have we ever gone against a recommendation from the Army Corps of Engineers?
Typically not.
What's the reason? Why do we typically not go against the Army Corps of Engineers recommendations?
Well, ultimately, I think it just depends on how much money somebody wants to spend on impacts. Obviously, it becomes an expensive proposition. Plus, there's some environmental impacts. I think that's why the Army Corps recommended against it. So there's all, there's their environmental impacts as well, and that's why they charge what they charge for those impacts, to try to minimize those.
So it would be difficult for the city to grant approval if the Army Corps of Engineers recommends building the home north of the stream, if they were to go ahead and build it south of the stream.
It would depend on the size of the home being considered. There may be room over on this side to build a home, but not the proposed home that the council is considering.
Any other questions by any council member prior to taking the vote?
I have one. I have a question for the property owner. Hello, Mr. Basic. How long have you owned the property? Do you mind coming up?
Bought the property in 62 or 63, so probably 56
so
years.
So that you own the property, or your father, and then you.
Vice Mayor Meany, were you sworn?
No, I wasn't.
Okay.
Well, you swore at the last I didn't think I was going to get.
I didn't know if that carried over.
Do you swear affirm the testimony you give, or the evidence you present will be the truth, the whole truth?
I do.
Okay.
Okay, so your family, first your father, and then right. Then you have owned the property since 1962. Mm-hmm. So before the O'Neill development?
Oh, yeah. When and I grew up, O'Neill's property was actually a polo field for the O'Neill farm, and we used to watch the horses out in the pasture.
Right, okay.
So when the development got put in, it kind of was the same feeling. We were sad to see it go, but Dad always said if you couldn't afford to buy it or you didn't buy it, that's just the way it was.
Okay. And then through the years, when was the first time that you put the property, up for sale or?
I think we originally put up for sale probably about 4 years or 5 years ago, something like that.
Okay. But all through since 1962, you've been paying the taxes on that property.
Pay taxes on the property, correct.
Okay. Right. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions by any council person before we go to vote? Mr. Couture, you had your hand up?
I did. I had a question for the planning director. During the planning commission meetings, would it be accurate to say it was the position of the planning department that a home could be built inside of the 220-foot setback mark?
The only plans that were submitted were at the 220 to 230 some foot setback. I think there was one at 189. There was no plan submitted at the 67 foot setback to be reviewed.
Okay. For the engineer, during caucus, the assistant engineer had mentioned that he felt that there was the ability to construct a home inside of the 220-foot setback mark. Do you agree with Mr. Linden's assessment of that, Mr. Bush?
I would generally agree with that, although I wouldn't think it would be the same size as what the council is considering tonight.
Right. Okay. The letter that was submitted from the Army Corps of Engineers appeared to me to be more of a form letter and a recommendation based on an overall general rule of thumb, so to speak. Mr. Bush, would you agree that that's accurate in the way I'm describing it, or do you believe that is specific to this very parcel?
I would think that they looked at this generally, I think they looked at this lot specifically. However, I think their comments are general in the fact or in regards to their requirements.
Any other questions before we I ask for a vote?
I was just going to make the motion.
Okay, I'd like the motion then to be made. Motion to grant the variance as requested by the applicant and overturn the decision of the Planning and Zoning Commission.
I make...
And I need a motion and a second on that.
I'll make the motion.
Okay.
I'll second it.
Everybody understand how to vote? If you're in favor of the variance, it's yes. And if you want to uphold the decision of the Planning Commission, it's no. I'll ask them, Mrs. Chairman, do you want... How you want to proceed to the vote? In what order? I'll leave that to you.
Here.
Oh, I mean, want to go right to left or?
We'll do it how we normally do it.
Do it roll call.
Do the roll call.
Do it.
Okay. Are we ready? All right, Mr. Katora?
No.
Mr. McGill?
No.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
No.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.
Mr. Zellin?
Yes.
4-3.
4-3. I think the motion to grant the variance is successful, and they have the right to build the house as in the application. I will tell everybody in the room that anybody, as a matter of law, has a right to appeal under 2506 as an interested party. I'll let you and your attorneys, if you do decide to appeal this matter to the Court of Common Pleas, but this decision is now a finalized decision, and this hearing is over. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, everybody. I thought we should all have our reasons. Give me a second to let everybody clear out.
Okay.
Everybody clear out before we started? Okay, we'll move on then to item number 10.
Okay, number 10 is ordinance number 2019-107. An ordinance adopted pursuant to Article 12 of the Solon Charter, proposing amendments to Article 4, Section 5C, and Section 6, Article 5, Section 4, Article 6, Section 3, Article 9, Title, and adding Article 9, Section 1A4, and amending Article 9, Section 1D, repealing Article 9, Section 1E, and amending Article 14, Sections 1 and 2, and adding Article 14, Section 3, pertaining to initiative petitions and elections on zoning code, land use, and zoning map changes, and declaring an emergency, and this is the second reading.
Okay, we are going to leave this on second reading, but I also want to schedule a public hearing on this charter changes. For our next meeting, which is June 17th. Okay. Item 11.
Ordinance number 2019-108, an ordinance enacting section 234.017 of the Administration Code, Business Operations Administrator. And this is also the second reading.
Okay, and we're gonna leave this on second reading. Item number 12.
Request from Ara Bagdasarian to introduce the Solon Community Living Project. This item was referred to the law director, assistant law director, and planning director on May 20th, and the item has been tabled and there's no new material.
Okay. Okay, under new, we have nothing. Under correspondence, we have nothing. Under consent, we have nothing. Okay, I'm moving for comments from the audience. Any comments from the audience? Okay, seeing none, we'll move to comments from council, starting with Mr. Palunas.
Nothing this evening.
Mr. Schimmitz.
I'd like to wish my wife, Mary, a very happy anniversary tomorrow. 24 years of marital bliss with my best friend.
That's it. Okay, Mr. Zetlin.
So first I want to start off addressing Mr. Fisher's remarks. I've been in contact with several residents in the Fox Run area over the last year and a half. I've been in communication with Mr. Bush, the engineer, Mr. Dursick, as well as the illuminating company. I'm going to defer some comments to John, Bill, someone over there, to address what we're trying to work on there. I know this has been an area of frustration. I've been hearing complaints since the day I was elected, and I've been in communication with the engineering department and public works commission since I was elected, trying to get First Energy to do something. And I think that's one of the challenges that people need to understand, right? The city doesn't own, unfortunately for the city, we don't own our utility. So there's only so much control that we have over upgrading the power lines. And it's becoming very frustrating of 7 years of challenges for the residents of Fox Run. But I'll let the engineering department defer this. I also want to ask Mr. Franklin, it's that time of the year again where grass is growing and people are getting frustrated with properties that may be vacant or their neighbors that don't mow enough. If you can address some of the variances, or not the variance, the ordinances related with grass height, and Mr. Dursick, maybe you can also address what the city does to help maintain some of that area that exceed those boundaries. Lastly, I'm going to address Matthew Seifert, his comments tonight on behalf of John Solange. So I was elected about a year and a half ago, right? And one of the things I ran on when I was elected was being open and transparent and honest with people. And sometimes honesty and being open with people disagree with you, right? And that's part of being an elected official, is that people disagree with you. And a comment that I've made to many residents that I disagree with on this subject, on the winery, on the mosque, on any various issues, it's okay to disagree. We disagree all day long. I disagree with people every day. I disagree with people that I sit up here every day. But what it's not okay to be disagreeable, right? And often, a lot, I would say over the last 6 to 8 months, when people disagree, they're often disagreeable. People have oftentimes been disagreeable. And it's okay to disagree. I just ask that people are respectful when they disagree with me. As far as what happened outside city council chambers, I can't speak to that because I wasn't there and I don't know what happened. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Russo.
Right. Well, Jeremy, just on that Fox Run, I'll just mention that we had a similar issue in Hunt Club. It took a number of years to find out exactly where the problem is. And that's one of the issues when you have utilities underground, is that when there is a problem, it is difficult for the illuminating company to exactly pinpoint where that is. And eventually they will find it. But when there are issues, one of the reasons why they ask residents to make sure they call in when they have an outage is so that they can start locating and then build a history for the case so that it can help them find the cause. Second thing, as far as Jeremy, you mentioned the zoning code with grass. Again, I've mentioned this, and I'm going to be putting this in my newsletter again, usually typically every July. I mentioned it, our zoning code is reactive. Typically, the zoning inspector is not going out unless there's a complaint. I've always asked my residents to provide me the exact address and the issue that they want the zoning inspector to address. When that is received, it's given to Mr. Franklin. Mr. Franklin gives it to the zoning inspector. She goes out there, and I'd say a good portion of the time she's already aware of the issue. Just because it's brought to the attention doesn't mean there's immediate action taken. They've got to find out who the true owner of the property is, and once that's done, if they're not on site, she has to issue a citation to make sure it's received before action is taken. But again, residents need to realize that that zoning code is reactive. City is not going out looking for issues. Third, I'd like to congratulate Olivia Howell. She was a double state winner. 800 and the 1600 meters. Not only is it difficult to win one event, But to win two events, and especially those two, is an outstanding achievement. So congratulations to Olivia.
Thank you. Mr. Couture.
I, too, would like to congratulate Olivia. This is really an impressive achievement. I thought we were going to have some discussion prior to the vote. So I think it's, I always like to try to speak as to why I voted a certain way. So with respect to the appeal this evening, you know, I thank Mr. and Mrs. Greenspan for being very civil. And I have no doubt that they are great neighbors and excellent citizens. Many of our families have interesting stories about the journey of how they ended up in the United States. And I'm pretty sure that most of those stories don't include the Secretary of State. So with respect to Mr. Greenspan's father, I'm sure that he's a very interesting individual to talk to, and I'm sure all of us would probably enjoy sitting down, spending some time listening to his courageous journey, the stories of his courageous journey to get here. But the decision, the position that we were put in as a legislative body is a, as the law director terms it, a quasi-judicial. We became a quasi-judicial body where we're asked to evaluate evidence, not personal facts or personal stories. And I just wanted to be clear that my vote did not have, there was nothing personal about my vote. There, what I determined my vote based on was the facts that I saw in the case. We are a municipality. Being that we're a municipality, we have a charter, we have ordinances, and a zoning code. And as a member of the city council, each one of us has to take an oath to uphold our rules and regulations, our charter, our zoning. So for me, the decision to vote no on the appeal was based on the fact that I felt that there was substantial evidence that was presented that the lot was buildable, was usable, and that the minimum buildable portion of the lot did not start at the 220-foot setback. So I wanted to be clear, based on the facts that I feel I was presented with both at the Planning Commission, during caucus at the Planning Commission, and as well as in the last two hearings here at City Council. So based on those facts, not the personal things that were discussed, but on those facts, that is the reason why I voted no. As far as Mr. Seifert's concerned, I want to be clear that I condemn bullying of all types. And I believe that residents should feel comfortable that they can come to this body and exercise their First Amendment rights. Those are my comments for the evening.
Thank you. Mr. McGill.
Matthew, once again, thank you for having the courage to get up and speak in front of this body. I know that's not easy at your age, and I am grateful that you took the opportunity to bring our attention to this and speak on the behalf of Mr. Solange. To my knowledge, this is the second circumstance where one of the individuals involved has done something like this. And we need to reaffirm that it's not acceptable or appropriate within the framework of reasonable discussion and disagreement. Doesn't represent our aspirations as a community, and that we should never engage in that kind of bullying behavior. I'd like to congratulate our girls softball team. They won their first district title since 2013, though they fell in the regionals. Good for them. And our boys track team won their fourth straight district title, which is pretty cool. I won't speak about Olivia Howell because I know our mayor was down there, and I know he's going to say something about it, so we'll leave that. But congratulations to her. She won all four of her events at the 10th straight district championship that our girls track team won before the state. That was really impressive. Several of our boys were all Ohioans as well, and a special congratulations tonight to our high school graduates that are now off on their next stage of their career and their lives. We wish them all the best. And I know
My daughter Katie speaks about this. She went to Xavier after graduating from Solon High School, and she felt she was extremely well prepared at a top flight university like that. So I know that our graduates are well prepared for what they're going to be facing next in life. Congratulations to them, and congratulations to Joe Regano and the school for doing that. And special congratulations to our high school and middle school science Olympiad teams. They took second place in the national tournament this last Saturday at Cornell University. That's a very impressive. Our national science Olympiad teams place frequently in the national events. It's really impressive. June 6th, Wednesday. I really would like everybody to remember the incredibly terrible sacrifice made by the brave young men of our country who stormed the beaches in Normandy 75 years ago on D-Day, June 6th. Thank you.
Okay, I do want to thank everyone who was involved in the Memorial Day event. I know it was a little different this year due to the road construction, but the Solon Band and the Boy Scouts, and especially the Solon VFW. And just, I want to give a shout out to the VFW. I really would like to encourage all Solon veterans, or if you're family of a veteran, please think about joining the VFW. I have the opportunity to play bocce there on Wednesday and Thursday nights. And it's just a great place. They have great food. And I just want to really encourage, residents who happen to be veterans, or like I say, have family members, to maybe give it a look. I also really want to congratulate Olivia Howell. Wow, that's really, really amazing. And like I say, kudos to her. That is not an easy feat to do something like that, especially in the same day. To echo off of Councilman Katora, I mean, my preference would have been for all of us to say our reasonings for why we voted tonight. I mean, just real briefly, I, like Mr. Katora, I mean, we have, as I'll just put it, real easily, rules and what should be allowed and setbacks. But, there's reasonings. People do ask us all the time. The Planning Commission is very busy with people coming in requesting variances. And these are always very difficult. I mean, I took a lot of time thinking about it. I was over on your road today. I was on O'Neill. I was looking, reviewing the evidence from the planning meeting, and to look back, a lot of the residents, what I was getting, I don't want my woods taken away. And I understand that. I grew up in Solon when a lot of Solon was almost all woods. And for every development that went in here, or when houses were built, we all went through that. Oh, wow, look, that's not there. When I grew up, there were two developments in this town, and that was Briar Hill and North Hill. So, and you see what's happened since then. So, I mean, I understand that. I looked at it that, especially with the Army Corps, that the Greenspans should be allowed to move their house back. Matter of fact, in recent years, had two streets on Spring Grove, which is off of Cannon, another home on Cannon, where we gave a 267-foot setback. And if you ever go down Cannon, it's on the north side of the street, the house is way back. The original house was closer, and we gave them a variance to move back. So we do it, and it's been done. It's been done twice in my ward. Is it something we do all the time? No, but I think, I felt that they, applicant should be allowed to build the home that he wants. I mean, I know he could have built a smaller home, maybe not have, be a little closer up. But if you really look at it, I think he would have been closer to O'Neill's if it would have been closer up. I think he'll be a little farther over. But anyways, I mean, I didn't take this lightly. I did spend a lot of time kind of going back and forth, because I understand, we have zoning laws, and just so that for all parties, I took a lot of time. It wasn't an easy decision, but I felt like there was enough, and the Army Corps was big. There's a stream there. Don't think we want to start messing around moving streams, and those were my reasons. So okay, moving on then to comments from council, starting,
I'll try to be brief.
Administration.
Now, to the Greenspans, we will work diligently now that the appeal has been granted. All our administration, our planning director,
planning department, our engineering, to make sure that you get what you want. So.
Sorry, did we miss the opportunity to speak the open?
Yeah. Oh.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
So just rest assured that our administration will work with you to make sure that what you get is what you want. So Mr. Seifert, our administration has dealt with it because it's with the police department. I'm not at liberty to discuss it, but I can tell you, rest assured you, that it has been dealt with. So thank you for appearing here this evening. I want to thank all the residents that appeared here tonight to make comments. I was at the track meet. It was pretty amazing. Just want to just sort of go over all the other young men and women that were down at the track meet. Greg Perry's took a eighth in the 100 meters, who's all Ohio, and a fourth in the 200. Evan Johnson, a sixth in the discus. The team of Greg Perry's, Kevin Perry, Ricky Roberts, and Brett Shannon finished third in the 4x100. Davin Miller finished eighth in the high jump. Sam Young finished seventh in the 800. Kelly Harmody got sixth in the seeded division shot put. And, you know, Olivia's race was pretty spectacular. So she ran the 1600, finished first for the third year in a row as the third time state champion in the 1600. And just a few short races after that, you know, she doubled up in the 800. And the other girls that she was running against in the 800, that was their first race. That was their only race. So they were all fresh, and she had just come off a 4:45 in the 1600. So the first lap, it was Olivia was holding back about 10th, 11th place. Actually, she was in 13th place in the back stretch. So she finished, overtook 13 people to win the state meet going back to back. And I always say, as she was running, you could tell she was pretty much going to pass everybody, because you can't measure heart when it comes to running on a track. So I want to congratulate her, congratulate the entire boys and girls track team. They just did a terrific job. This is coming after a boys cross country championship just a few years ago and a girls track championship back to back just a few years ago. So great program. I was at the commencement. I just want to congratulate, I won't read off all the names, but congratulate all the graduates. It was truly a remarkable program. Great speech by Aaron Short. And if you notice from the commencement, all of the honors diplomas, the National Technical Honor Societies, the National Honor Societies, it was just too much to mention. So great job for the Solon High School, all the graduates. I want to wish them congratulations and much success as they move forward. And just lastly, I just want to congratulate everyone who got together yesterday at Beechwood Place, ran the race for the place, those that have survived cancer. Saw a lot of Solon families, a lot of Solon residents there, and it was just a great opportunity to get together and to run and to walk and to raise money and just to promote each other. There's a lot of survivors in our community, and we should all be proud and supportive of all the survivors in the community. And the Gathering Place just does a great job of unifying everybody to make sure that at some point in our lives that we will cure cancer. So those are my comments.
Mrs. McConney.
No comments.
Mr. Lobey.
I have one. I'd like to thank Lon Stolarski, who's been filling in for me during my issue. I just want everybody to know I trust in his sage legal advice. I bounce things off him very often. He quietly but confidently has been a really good help to me, and we work good together, and I think this latest thing when he handled this matter is a clear example of it. And I've never said thank you to him since we've been working together, so tonight's the night, Lon. I want everybody to know it publicly. Thank you.
Thank you.
It's one big issue.
Chief Island.
Nothing tonight, thank you.
Chief Shaw.
No comments, thank you.
No comments, is he?
Mr. Franklin.
Yes, address Councilman Zellman's question. The zoning inspector has been very busy this year on grass. That's usually the number one complaint that she does get. And this year, with the number of days that it has rained, not necessarily the amount, but just the fact that there's not many breaks in days that it has rained, it's made it an even tougher year. What the requirements are regarding grass, in any zoning issues, it has to be a nuisance. The zoning code defines grass being a nuisance when it is 8 inches or taller. Then the zoning inspector can act at that point on the property. As Councilman Russo indicated, she does follow up on those. She does have the ability to give notice, 48-hour notice by certified mail or other means. A lot of times the difficulty is in actually finding the property owner. She does tend to stay on top of these things, though, and certainly if she sees highly overgrown grass, you know, well over 8 inches, she will act on those on her own. But Councilman Russo is correct. If you call or contact her by email, then it'll be given a priority and the city would move ahead even quicker on it. In particularly problem cases, we can hire to have a contractor come in and mow the grass. We add 25% to the cost. Occasionally the service department does help us out on the mowing as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mrs. Shaker?
No report tonight, thank you.
Mr. Dursick?
First, I'd like to thank Mr. Brody for the kind words from the beginning of the meeting. Thank you again. Just to follow up with Rob said, once the zoning process has been exhausted, and if the contractor can't cut it, then service will come in and help the planning department out with the grass. And with regards to the power outage on Hunter's Ridge, or I'm sorry, Fox Run, Mr. Russo's right. The residents do need to contact CEI for the outages. We have put a call into Dave Connolly, and the follow-up from some of the work that Dave Dillon has done, they're working on a 12-month outage report for that street. We'll follow up with Dave this week to make sure that's been done, and then we'll move forward from there. And if John has any more information, he can add to it.
Mr. Bush?
I think Bill was pretty thorough. I have nothing else to add.
Thank you. Hey, I'll entertain a motion.
Motion to adjourn.
Second. Motion by Mr. Russo, seconded by Mr. Zellwin. Roll call, please.
Ms. Katara?
Yes.
Mr. McGill?
Yes.
Mrs. Meany?
Yes.
Mr. Palunas?
Yes.
Mr. Russo?
Yes.
Mr. Schimmitz?
Yes.